your friend can usability fellow who will tell us more about the habits in user experience, Dimitar Simovjevic.
Thank you, Stefan.
Hello.
Hello, my microphone. Oh, now you can hear me. Okay. I can hear myself. Okay, I want to tell you something. It's I wasn't planning on telling it to you, but and now I will. This is where I was supposed to be today. This is the sunrise on the first day of the summer last year. So I have this habit of going to the seaside to meet the first day of the summer. I don't go on the 1st of July like everybody else. I go on the first day of the summer. But I stayed here because of this event. Well, I broke my habit. Okay, anyway, I want to ask you to have like a pen or pencil, whatever, some writing device and a piece of paper. Just please, everybody, just take it. I want to feel like we are back to school. And you have to have your right to be there. You ready? You have a writing device? Good. I want you to put your signature on the paper. Just sign it. I'm not kidding. Done? Okay. Now do it with your other hand. What? Same other still. So the other hand it was harder, right? You were wondering, how did it that? You have to think about it, right? Okay, so why is it different? Any idea? Habit, exactly. That's one of what we're going to talk today. Okay, I'm going to tell you about the current understanding about habits that goes around in the world. Well, maybe not everything, but what I learned from reading some TED books. I'll give you some examples showing habits successful, not successful, but habits. And then at the end, I will claim that it's the job of us designers to think about users' habits, because this is important and this helps shape the overall user experience. Now, my focus of this talk is on user experience, on usability, on interaction. Habits, it's a huge field. There is habits related to addictions. You can talk about habits and how to shape people's habits so you can convert more customers. No, I'm not going to focus on this. User experiences in terms of usability. A few words about myself. Stefan already introduced me. Yes, please call me Jimmy. Everybody does that for the last 30 plus years. So it's a habit of mine to be called Jimmy. So it's okay. Otherwise, I'm called Dimitar Simov. Stefan said, I'm a UX practitioner. I've done all kinds of things related to UX. I gradually understood that these are related to user experience. And currently, I am working at SAP as a product experience expert for the SAP HANA Cloud Platform, which is SAP's platform as a service offer. Now, my goal today is not to teach you, not to deliver something that you don't know. I wanted to start thinking about habits when designing. That's my only goal. So let's go. you don't see everything, right? That's bad. How do you fix this? Well, in the first place, I think it was okay. Anyway, let me show you something like this. I lock my computer. And you don't see this, right? That's amazing, technology. Now we have to do this several times. I don't know, no. Okay, so we want to log into Windows. So I do this. Aha, now you see. So when you log into Windows, you just see this. You have to type your password, right? So I type my password. You don't see, now you see. Oh, my password is incorrect. Okay, this happens. Now it's correct. Okay, so far so good. But I'm bilingual, which means I speak Bulgarian and English. So I type in Bulgarian and English. Now, suppose that I am editing a document.
You see?
Yes, you see it. In Bulgarian. And I'm writing Zdrasti UX5. Okay? Then I have to go to the bathroom or something. I have to lock my computer. This is all corporate policy. Nobody has to be able to go to my computer. I come back and I want to log in, right? So what they do, I type my password. The password is incorrect. You know why?
You're in Bulgarian keyboard.
I'm in Bulgarian, exactly. Here. This is Bulgarian. Well, I've been using Windows for the last 20-something years, probably, or maybe less. And I have never had this problem before, because the login screen was always in Latin. And yes, used the Latin alphabet. And now when I switch to Windows 8, or 8.1, whatever, these things suddenly started appearing. And I would type my password. This happens like 5 or 6 times a day, or maybe more. And I will type my password. And why am I doing this? I have to switch back to English. And I'm still doing it. I never see that it's in Bulgarian. Why? That is a habit. Logging into Windows is a habit. I don't think about it. I just do it. And now with this new Windows 8.1, my habit is broken. Because I have to switch. It's a small thing, right? It's just pressing the Alt Shift, it's easy, it's fast, but I have to do it, entering my password a couple of times. Bad thing. Okay, let's go back to where we were. Now the magic of technology happens. Okay, now I see the whole thing. Okay. So, what's a habit? And the definition says that it's a routine of behavior that is repeated regularly and tends to go unnoticed, unconscious. This comes from Wikipedia. So the important things here is that it's a routine. That's something that happens in a routine way, the same way, more or less. And the other important thing is unconsciously. We don't think about it. We don't notice it. That's why habits are powerful, because they just happen without us consciously noticing them. And research indicates that 40 to 50% of our behavior, everything, is habitual. 40 to 50%. You can, I don't know, yeah, you have to think about it, to imagine it. Almost half of what we do it on autopilot. We don't even think about it. So, I have this question. Can you ride a bike?
Yeah.
Bicycle? Yeah? Okay. Now, I need a volunteer. Come on, come here, please. Ima- Imagine that this is your my bicycle. I give it to you for a ride. Okay? Can you please ride my bicycle? Then just hold it. Hold this with your two hands and go. Go straight. No, go ahead. Just go straight. Please. I will tell you. Just go ahead. Go straight. Yes, my bicycle. Okay, now turn left. No, just go straight. First go straight and turn left. Okay, continue straight. Just go, turn right and continue. Just like riding a bicycle. So you go right, left, right? No, that's how we do it. Okay, now imagine there is a bike. Now imagine that this bike is a little bit different. This one has this little device. So in order to go left, you have to turn the wheel right. Okay? Now let's ride again. Okay? Just go straight and I'll be telling you which direction to go. Okay. Now just go this way so the people can see you. Uh-huh. Just go straight. Now turn left. Yeah. But you didn't turn the wheel. Okay? Try it again. Turn left. Turn right. No, the point was that the wheel, in order to turn left, you have to turn the wheel right. So you have to go this way. Turn right, but go. Okay? Any question? No? It's a difficult bike, isn't it? Well, thank you very much. It was there is actually a person who did this, and I want to show. Whoa. Okay. You see that, right? I have to be like this. Where's my mouse? Technology.
Where's my? On the other screen.
That's amazing. You don't have to hear it, you can just see. But there's the bike. See the bike? Turn the wheel to the left. Okay? And you have to ride it, right? Just like you ride the bike. And there's this guy who's going, if I need this full screen, it's a little bit better. And so okay. Anyway, you see now. So that's how it goes. It rises. Okay, and he says, okay, I'm not just some guy who can't ride a bike, I'm quite a skilled person. And then he says, okay, that's how you ride a bike. You have to just push pedals, their forces going, you lean your body, so on. And this guy goes to different events where he talks in front of people. And he says, I bet you whatever you want that you can't ride this bike. He goes for everybody in the world. No, still can't do it. He offered this guy $200 to ride the bike. So it goes. Yes, you can find this and watch it. It's a nice movie. Okay. I guess you already guessed why I'm showing this example. It's a habit. When you ride a bike, you don't think about it. You just do it. And can somebody learn to ride this bike that goes the other way? Yes, this person actually took him 6 months until he learned to ride the bike. And then guess what happened when he sat on a normal bike? He couldn't do it. Yeah, just watch the movie, it's wonderful. So why habits are important and why I'm talking about habits? Why important to us? Habits are an excellent, amazing energy management tool. It's a mechanism that through automation helps our minds and body self save energy. So by doing something on autopilot, by habit, it means that you don't have to take decisions, right? You just do it. Think about it. If you have to think to take decisions about walking, like I'm going to lift this leg now, I'm going to flex these muscles now, and these muscles, you can't do it. In terms of processing your power, you will get mad. So by not making decisions all the time, this helps us lower our cognitive load. So our brain can do much more interesting things. Think about fun, this beautiful cake, the steaks that I'm going to eat tonight, the movie that I watched, and so on and so on. This also reduces the exertion of our willpower. Now, willpower is an interesting thing. Will is something that works like a muscle. It gets tired. You have noticed it by yourself. In the morning, you have more willpower than you have in the evening. And if I now start doing this, how long can you stand or sit listening to this? And imagine that after that, I ask you to do a mind-intensive exercise. No, you can't. So willpower gets exhausted. And by habitual behaviors, well, our willpower gets saved. Which means less stress, right? Which eventually means better self-control. Which at the end means more happiness. And at the end, that would mean, I think, better user experience for our users. Of course, I'm trying to put this in the perspective of what we do. Now, I need another volunteer. Okay? So, the idea here is to not click. Give me a second. I'll switch to, okay, so I can see this and this. So, here's a mouse. So that's a website, and you have to click here once, and then you don't click, but still navigate the site. Well, the surface there is not very good for moving the mouse, but hey, can you vote now? Okay.
Did I manage it?
I don't know. How does it feel?
Like I have no idea what I did. Just.
Okay. That's again a habit of ours. We're so used to clicking that you have to click. It's fun, right? Okay, it's another habit. Where's my presentation? Okay. So again, a habit, a strong habit. So habits are things that happen here in the mind.
And especially researchers say they happen here in something called basal ganglia. Very scientific, right?
So these are certain cores of
ancient brains, these are in fact. These are formations in the brain that have developed evolutionary before this thing developed and before this thing developed. And
so these are things that probably lizards have and like very ancient organisms have. But what they do is they automate the things. How they found out that these things work there? Because there are certain people who have damages to their brain and they can't remember a thing from what happens today. But still they can make their way through life. There was this patient, very famous, and the story goes like this. They asked him, he's in his house, he lives there for like a couple of years or more. And they ask him, okay, where's the kitchen? He doesn't know. But if they ask him, okay, what do you do when you're hungry? Show me. He goes to the kitchen, opens the fridge, produces something from the fridge, closes it, and starts eating. So consciously, he doesn't know where the kitchen is, but subconsciously, his body knows where the kitchen is. So that's the basal ganglia. That's a habit that has been built by so many repetitions he has been in the kitchen. That's how it goes. That's why we know that this place is the ganglia. So thinking about habits, for example, my suspicion why search and thus Google are successful is that searching is a habitual behavior. And going through indexes is not. Think about it. How do we grow up as kids when we have a question, we don't know anything? We just ask our parents, our siblings, people nearby. How do I do this? They tell us. How do I go there? They tell us. What's search? Search is exactly the same thing. You just have the same. How do I do this? And Google tells us. And the going through indexes, that's something that scientists can do, scholars can do, but not the rest of us. So how habits are formed? I started telling about this, like as kids, we ask somebody. So there is this cue, action, result. There's a three steps in the whole thing. So the cue, something triggers the whole thing, the habit. Could be anything. You see something, somebody tells you something, something happens, many things. Then follows an action, what we perform, right? And then there is a result. It's quite simple. The result can be a reward for what happened. Yes, you go to the casino, you insert the coin, that's the action, you rotate something, and you get the reward, or you don't get anything. Or the result can be lack of punishment. You behave properly, you go out, you're a teenager, you go out, you come back by 10 o'clock, and you don't get punished. You come back later, you get punished, for example. And there is a fourth step that is important probably for us here as designers. It's added by Neil Eyal, which is a hook model, and he says, well, the fourth step for users should be investment. That is, in order for users to get habitual with your product, they have to invest some time in something. Otherwise, they will stop using it. Check on his video. It's a very nice presentation on the food model. I want to tell now a story about the ribbon. Microsoft Office and the ribbon, right? You all familiar with that? Yeah, good.
Now, this is what happened. In 2007, Microsoft came up with a new solution for the way the controls were ordered and positioned on the interface. And they call this the ribbon.
sound? No. So this is the ribbon. And before that, this is August 2003, where there were toolbars. Do you remember the toolbars?
Yeah.
Some people remember the toolbars. Do you miss the toolbars?
No.
Who misses the toolbars? Why?
Because I missed it.
Missed it. Wasn't behavior. Okay, I missed the toolbars too. Let me tell you why. But first, why Microsoft did this change? They said there are too many toolbars. And if you put them all on the screen, you have a very little screen real estate for writing. Absolutely true. Nobody wants to use a word in this way, right? But before that, let me tell you this. We people have a particular way of learning things. First, we start as novices. We don't know anything, and we relatively quickly master some skills. Then, at this point, so if we start here, we don't know that we don't know. We are unconsciously incapable. So that's everything's fine. Then, as we add up some skills, we start to be consciously incapable. So here, at this point, we are already consciously capable. And then we start to forget, and then we become unconsciously capable. At this point, we have mastered the interface. And we are unconsciously capable, which means we perform many things by habit, right? Okay. So, and this curve, if we do this for word, over time, most people will learn like a part of the functionalities in Word, like 20% or something, and will never learn the rest of it. There's a small part of the people who will learn maybe 30, 40, 50% of the Word. And there are different, these extra 20, 30% are different for the different masters, because it depends on who does what. And toolbars, that's the story with toolbars. Toolbars had this, this mastery of being, or this feature, you could customize the toolbars. You can show one toolbar or another, there was flexibility. You can build your own toolbar and put whatever controls you needed there. Now, this was lost through this interface because you could not control it. Something else was lost. The flexibility to rearrange things and put them in the way you want. That's what a master does, right? Because when you're masterful with something, you want to put your tools in whatever way makes sense to you. That's what Word 2003 offered through the toolbox. And this one doesn't. Okay, it didn't go absolutely wrong. Of course, it was a good thing. For example, in terms of habit and talking, they preserved the old shortcuts. Even today, these shortcuts work. 10 years later. Do you know what they do? Anyone using shortcuts?
Kind of.
That's good. Somebody knows what they do. And they also preserve the visual appearance of the buttons and the names of the controls. So there was a transition. So part of the habits that people have built were preserved, but some of them were lost. So ever since 2007, I personally can't use Word in the way I used to use it before that. Because these shortcuts that I used to have built myself, or the menus that I have been used to using, I can't have them anymore. So why I'm telling you this story? Because change in the interface in the UI might break some habits that your users have already established. And believe me or not, we are so flexible, we are so wonderful automation machines that we always build habits when we start using something, when things recur repetitive work. I want to give you a couple of directions how to approach designs in order to support user habits. And the most important thing, I think, is consistency. And it can be consistency within a single product. So what's the idea? The same element should be called the same, it should behave the same, regardless of in which form it appears. Here's an example. Now, these are small things, but this is essentially the same interface element. Right? It's a form. But look at this. Look at the buttons here. Right? They're not the same size. Is it a big thing? Maybe not. Look at the labels. Now, these are aligned to the right, and these are aligned to the left. It's the same product. Well, these two were built by different teams. And they were built before there were, like, there were guidelines. If you have guidelines, and your teams follow those, well, you might be able to provide consistency. Within product families, that gets a bit harder. Think about the Office, Microsoft Office, Word, Excel. So here's an example. Format, Painter shortcut. You know this little brush here? You can take it and copy the formatting from one piece of text to another piece of text. So this is how it looks, and these are the shortcuts for it. You build a habit of pressing Control Shift C and then Control Shift V, and you transfer this. Well, in OneNote, you still have this. You don't have this. I don't know why you don't have this. And in Excel, well, there's no shortcut. So it's you are about to build your habit of using Control Shift C, but then work in Excel, and you can't do it. So that's a problem. So this kind of consistency can be very useful. Of course, there could be a consistency across product worldwide. And like Control C, when talking about shortcuts, everybody, everywhere, Control C is copy. I don't know about Macintosh, maybe there's no Control C, there's this Command C or something.
Yeah.
And another example for like search. Where's the search box?
Top right.
Top right. Okay. That's a habit. It's there. Everybody's looking into it there. Top right or top middle or something like that. It's not in the bottom. Or if it's the only thing on the page, like Google, it can be anywhere. And again, search. How does search work? How does search result return results? If your search does not return results the way Google does, your users will be confused because they're used to Google. That's a habit of theirs to use Google. So, and building search, try to make it work the same way as Google search. Use patterns. These are very well established, and that's very close to consistency, patterns, as these are things that repeat, reoccur. So, for example, a form, the pattern here is there is a boxes, and a button at the end. That's a pattern. And we are used to it. If you change the pattern, for example, suppose that Facebook decided to put the button up here, I bet that there will be a good amount of people who will not be able to find it. That's habitual. Go on and click. Something else that you might want to do to avoid breaking users' habits, gradual change, evolutionary. When things change very slowly, we easily adapt our patterns, our habits to them. But if we do a big bang change, a total redesign, our current website sucks, we will change it completely, the new one will be perfect. No? Might be, but your users will be not there. So just follow Jarvis Poole's advice and do it like Amazon. He says, when I ask people whether Amazon changed their design, the answer is no. The fact is that Amazon is changing their design all the time. But they do it in a very step-by-step fashion, goes in glacial speed approach, very slow, evolutionary. And of course, course, try to make your products usable. Well, that means they should match what your users expect, what their goals are, what their needs are. So, in summary, just to put it again in perspective, habits are very powerful automation tools that make us stay sane and happy. We are a wonderful habit building machine, so are our users, right? And so when designing things, try to think about habits, try to make things consistent, try to make usable things, and try not to break those habits. And who's to think about that? Nobody else but us. Users can't think about it. They're just using it. One more thing about habits. I said I wanted to think. And I wanted to think about your development process. And I claim that most of the things you do in your development process are habitual. We already said that 40 to 50% of what we do is habitual. So why the development process should be an exception? So probably in your development process, there are things that you do by habits that if you start thinking about, you might find out that, oh, you can do this better and thus offer better user experience in your product. And now by habit, the speaker can take questions. So habitual to be silent that you can't say. Okay, if there's no question, then thank you very much. You can tweet, find me on Twitter, or I'll be here for a few more half an hour. I won't be here through the rest of the day, unfortunately. But yeah, if you want to talk, grab me in the next half an hour. Thank you.